In theory, if there were as much matter as there were antimatter, it all just would have annihilated and we just would have had a universe of energy. But again, it was that one part in a trillion, a little bit more matter that may have explained why we are here today.
So, Peter,
yes,
it's not uncommon these days to hear people describe the current state of things as upside down.
I think that's fair to say in the last 6 months. A lot of people's lives have been upside down a lot longer than that, but everybody's been sort of upside down the last 6 months.
No doubt about it, but possibly because of that, some news that came out, I believe it was April, you know, smack dab in the middle of where COVID was really blowing up, so to speak. And of course, there was a lot of attention on that. And you could argue potentially why this didn't get as much attention as it did.
So many things got buried.
Yes, and absolutely. And to be honest, even within that, taking that all into account, it maybe did get a relatively lot of coverage. But there was a story in April that there was an experiment going on through NASA up in the Arctic. We'll get into that a little later. But essentially what the results had shown was potentially evidence that a parallel universe existed where time went backwards. And of course, that was the juicy headline. Universe, you know, parallel universe discovered with where time goes backwards. People were like, what?
Hell on earth.
But I don't, yeah. And I mean, I think, you know, some people were like, well, whatever. But other people were like, wait a sec, what the hell are you talking about here?
It was matter's evil twin,
our friend or enemy, Antimatter.
Yeah, I remember hearing the backwards universe theory.
Yeah, which again, I mean, interestingly, the movie Tenet is out now where that idea of time going backwards is actually, it's not a spoiler, people, relax. It's in the trailer. But this idea that there could be literally an opposite universe, a bizarro world, if you will.
Like in Superman.
And it's not something I realized. Antimatter is not something we know very much about.
Do you know who does know a lot about antimatter?
Our guest today?
Of course.
Liz Landau.
Liz Landau is an award-winning journalist and science communicator. A self-professed lifelong nerd, Liz is interested in astronomy, particle physics, archaeology, allergies, math, music, and of course, the number pi.
Pi.
Liz holds a bachelor's degree in anthropology from Princeton University and a master's in journalism from Columbia University. Liz spent 6 years at CNN before joining NASA in 2014.
Liz, welcome to What If Discussed.
Oh, it's so great to be here. Thanks so much for having me.
So in the beginning, as Peter and I were talking about off the top, according to Big Bang Theory, a lot of energy was created.
A lot.
A lot of matter was created. A lot of antimatter was created. And then somehow the matter won out. We get galaxies and planets and stars and Peter and Richard and Liz. And kind of there's still a pretty big mystery as to what happened to the antimatter. And I'm sure I'm butchering this, but that's why you're here. Care to posit a guess as to what happened? It could be worth a Nobel Prize that maybe you could share with Peter and I.
Right? Yeah. So as you said, and it's kind of like that Bare Naked Ladies song that plays at the beginning of the show, The Big Bang Theory. Our whole universe was in a hot, dead state. Then nearly 14 billion years ago, expansion started. Wait, like that's actually accurate in that song. But in any case, in those first moments, there was this creation of equal amounts of matter and antimatter. And it is, as you said, such a mystery about why we are all made of matter today. And in fact, it would have only taken one in a trillion of an imbalance, one part in a trillion more matter than antimatter to give rise to the universe that we see today. And you know, what was responsible for that one part in a trillion is still a mystery. I don't have any particular guesses of my own, but the particle physicists at places like CERN in Europe are really looking at what kind of physical processes could give rise to an imbalance of matter and antimatter, such as when certain particles decay.
Math, science, history, unraveling the mystery.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen,
it all started with the Big Bang. Liz, you can obviously create a lot of energy by splitting an atom, as we found out, by creating nuclear power and ultimately nuclear weapons. How does that stack up with the energy created when matter and antimatter collide?
Yeah, so you might be surprised to know that while we don't see any antimatter around us, there actually is a tiny, tiny bit. And in fact, I brought an antimatter producer with me. This is a banana, hello. This banana, and any banana really, is actually producing a single particle of antimatter every 75 minutes or so.
What?
Wow. That's about how long a banana lasts in my house before it turns black.
And so, so if you got together all the bananas of the world, however, you still wouldn't have enough antimatter to produce the kinds of explosions that you might see in a sci-fi show.
So is that because of the potassium in the banana?
That's correct. Potassium-40 is a radioactive isotope, and that's why every 75 minutes or so, a single anti-electron or a positron is actually coming out. But a single particle, especially a single particle of antimatter, will not stay around for a while because it will immediately meet its evil twin, a regular electron, and they will annihilate. In fact, if the single particles annihilating is really not going to produce any noticeable effect, otherwise we would see flashing lights all the time, right? In fact, our own bodies produce a negligible but an amount of antimatter. But in any case, you would really need a gram of it. If you had a gram of matter and a gram of antimatter, that could actually produce the explosion of a nuclear bomb. However, we can all take comfort in the fact that it's nearly impossible to collect a gram of antimatter because these particles are so fleeting, they're annihilating with matter all the time, and it's very difficult to trap.
And in fact, very cost negligible, let's say, or I guess
costly.
Yeah. I could have just
not
said
cost very negligible. Costly. Opposite.
Because I mean, there's all sorts of numbers floating around as to what it would cost to create antimatter. I have 1 milligram of antimatter would be about $100 billion to produce. Why is creating antimatter so expensive?
Yeah, again, when you have only single particles of antimatter being created naturally and being annihilated in less than a second, you know, it's very difficult to amass them in any appreciable quantity. It's some of the experiments that they're doing, for example, the alpha experiment at CERN in Switzerland, they actually have to decelerate these particles and they have to have some kind of magnetic field to trap them. So you have to have like literally a magnetic trap to get all the antimatter together to even really study their properties in any appreciable way. And even, you know, that experiment is part of this huge nuclear research organization, CERN. And, you know, CERN also has the Large Hadron Collider, multi-billion dollar world's largest science experiment, which also, studies antimatter. So, just because of the tiny, tiny amount of antimatter available, it's so expensive to do anything meaningful with it scientifically.
One of the reasons people have looked into creating antimatter is to potentially power spaceships. Why would antimatter be effective as an energy source for space exploration?
Yeah, if you could get appreciable amounts of it together, if to have that huge explosion of annihilation of matter and antimatter together, that could be extremely powerful. A kilogram of antimatter and a kilogram of matter, if they were somehow able to come together, that could be like 1,000 atomic bombs. That would be a lot of energy, absolutely. But again, because it's so expensive, it is sort of impossible to do anything like that to harvest the power of antimatter right now.
It would probably be pretty dangerous to have in a spaceship too, I'm imagining all that power. Are there any other practical applications of antimatter that we know of?
Yeah, actually it's really awesome. In the medical field, we have what's called a PET scan that you might have heard of, which stands for positron emission tomography. And this is actually using antimatter to do brain scans non-invasively. What they do is they give you a substance that has a radioactive isotope in it. Just like bananas have radioactive potassium 40, you would get, you know, a harmless substance that has a radioactive element in it. And then as that radioisotope decays, it emits these antimatter particles that then interact with your brain, again, in a very harmless way because there are so few particles, but in a substantial way such that you can actually produce a brain scan.
So sort of like an MRI on steroids.
Yeah, I guess so.
That's the type of eloquent, articulate examples you get here on What If Discussed.
Scientists.
From Richard and Peter. So when I hear, you know, antimatter explained, and it's essentially the mirror opposite of matter. It, you know, it rotates at a negative versus a positive. And if you do a deeper dive, it's essentially, you know, up to matter's down, black to matter's white, that type of thing, which, you know, kind of sounds like Bizarro World Superman or a lot of the other sci-fi
Ebony
tropes.
Ebony and ivory.
And so that could get someone to wondering, and that someone, of course, is me. It sounds almost like parallel universe theory. And that might have been sort of crazy talk at some point if we were doing What If Discussed 10, 20, 30, 40 years ago. These days, with string theory and multiple universe theory being more accepted in mainstream physics, is this now something that could be the sort of the first real ability to, we talked off the top about that, the news that came out earlier in April about the, you know, maybe there was evidence or that, you know, there was a universe that time was going backwards, et cetera. Is antimatter maybe the sort of the window into really understanding that?
Well, I guess the short answer is we don't know. I mean, there's really no evidence that's substantial of a parallel universe or anything, but it is really intriguing that every particle we know has an evil twin, if you were to say something like that. And, you know, if you, Richard Feynman had a quote about, you know, if you were to meet your antimatter twin on Mars, like, don't shake hands, right? But yeah, I mean, right now, you know, antimatter is really most interesting to scientists because it really gives us this it's such a fundamental mystery about why we are the way that we are and really why we exist at all. Because again, in theory, if there were as much matter as there were antimatter, it all just would have annihilated and we just would have had a universe of energy. But again, it was that one part in a trillion that was a little bit more matter that may have explained why we are here today.
Doesn't sound random to me, but that, of course, is a story for another.
What if?
Can you stick around, Liz? Because we have plenty more to talk about. We will get to that on the other side on the extended version of What If Discuss, the audio podcast. Where can people find your work?
Oh, yeah. You can go to my website, LizLandau.com. You can follow me on Twitter. I'm co-hosting a podcast called Pod Paper Scissors that you can find on podpaperscissors.com. For NASA, I produce a podcast called Gravity Assist, which is at nasa.gov/gravityassist. And I also write songs about science that you can find on my YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/Liz Landau.
So you weren't just riffing off the top there. That's actually one of your many talents is singing, improv, and also talking about the solar system. Ladies and gentlemen, that is Liz Landau. Stick around for more with Liz on the other side. Where can people find that link, Peter?
Well, if you're watching the YouTube, you can find it right below the window This right down here. But if you're listening already on the podcast, don't go looking for a link. You can't. You're wearing headphones. You're not looking at a screen. There's no link to look for. Just keep listening. We'll continue with Liz Landau on the other side.
Okay, thanks, Liz. We'll talk to you later in the show.
It was so fun. Thank you so much.
Lots to talk about after that sort of first half discussion. Clearly, the people out there right now making bitcoins and in their basement with like 15 computers and whatever.
Oh my God. Imagine how much they could make if they had powered their computers with.
Two words for you. Antimatter. Get on it. It's basically the new gold.
Expensive. Oh, you mean you're talking about them finding antimatter. I thought you were talking about powering their Bitcoin computers with antimatter because those Bitcoin computers use quite a lot of electricity.
So here's the business plan. You create the antimatter, then you put that antimatter into powering those computers. You can make more antimatter and of course you're rich. You're a supervillain, you're a Bond villain, but that's another discussion. No, but in all seriousness, I mean, it is interesting that you have the top scientists on the planet Earth who all seem to have a consensus around the idea that at that Big Bang origin point, an equal amount of matter and antimatter is created. We're all in agreement on, okay. The antimatter essentially, for the most part, outside of bananas and some other floating around, disappears. Yeah. Anybody have any idea where the no? Anybody have any idea what it means? No. Like usually you'll have some rogue people, some scientists out there with some, some strong theories.
Theory about,
But basically, matter wins out. You have the creation of things that we see as solid. And antimatter is still a big question mark. And the place, again, not surprisingly, perhaps, because it was in the news so prominently years ago when they were looking for the God particle, CERN.
CERN.
They seems to be the place.
Well, they can create it.
Yes, but as she's talking about, I mean, I don't know what the price tag was of CERN to build CERN, but it's in the billions. It's, stories in the underground. Yeah. And when people were talking about that whole, again, the search for the God particle, the Higgs boson, if people, don't know the term. But, some people were asking questions, laymen like myself.
And myself.
Wait a sec. So let me get this straight here. You're going to be crashing particles of antimatter and matter into each other at close to the speed of light. Now, I just Googled here on Wikipedia. Dangerous. It seems to say when that happens, they self-annihilate and it creates some sort of energy level, as Liz talked about, that's on the scale with atomic bombs. Well, should I be concerned?
A lot of people thought perhaps we were going to create a black hole.
Yes. But we didn't know definitive. Well, you and I did.
We didn't. The layman, as you speak.
Yes.
But the scientists knew. They knew one particle versus one particle will create an explosion this big. A gram of antimatter versus a gram of antimatter will create an explosion X big.
Manageable. And it seems, again, when you're on the other side of history, things seem impossible, right? Again, we've talked about it before. I think it was like late 1800s, at the end of the 19th century, it was considered scientifically impossible for lighter than air flight, as it was called, flying. I think in 1908, the Wright brothers are flying a plane, like less than whatever, 10 years later, they took something that was completely inconceivable and literally considered impossible. And then they did it. We know how that story ended. Mm-hmm. Now, cut to we're going to the moon. So,
I mean, you could argue that story has not ended.
And absolutely. Yeah. And I agree. Well, maybe that's where I'm going unconsciously is that you figure out this antimatter issue and the energy that's created through that. And you could harness this. Now, we made the wrong, let's say we made a mistake. You could argue some people would say nuclear energy is a massive part of really cleaning up the world and getting it safer, but also getting rid of fossil fuels. Other people would say, no, I think splitting the atom was a mistake because of the ramifications of nuclear weapons. Do you trust us, Peter Smeachin, to be able to crack the nut on antimatter for the pluses it could create for the world versus the minuses?
I do. I do, because
faith in humanity.
Well,
I like
if you're if you're talking about the mistakes made with nuclear, I think we've realized as a civilization that we've that could have been a mistake in some ways that it's been utilized. I think going forward, people aren't. Maybe they are. I don't know. Maybe I'm thinking they aren't interested in using it as a weapon, but
yeah, somebody is.
Someone
but
is.
Maybe to your point,
Blofeld
again, a Bond villain. Yeah. There's always a Bond villain out there.
Yeah.
But ultimately, I think enough people understand that, you know, to your point, the learning from mistakes. Yes, we do repeat history and make mistakes. But if we're able to solve it's not free energy, which a lot of people have talked about, you know, basically taking energy out of essentially the ether and being able, because there's so much energy and such, we just haven't been able to figure that out.
It's not free energy yet.
It's not free energy yet.
Until we figure that out.
So again, perhaps a Nobel Prize in the future for both
for
Peter
me?
And I. Well, I think it would be a shared Nobel Prize. We'll let Liz know if her name is included on that. But I think if we're doing this show in 5 to 10 years, there's been a massive amount of progress on the understanding of antimatter and how to harness energy out of it, I hope.
Well, why don't we pick it up with Liz Landau on the other side in the extended audio podcast. Now, there's a link to that if you're watching on the YouTube. On the YouTube, kids.
You
you're watching
like
on the
my
YouTube?
Grandmother.
Yeah? If you're watching this on our
on
YouTube channel, there's a link to the extended audio portion right below you. Now that's, like I say, if you're watching, if you're listening to the podcast right now, just keep listening.
Nothing
it just keeps going. You don't have to go anywhere.
And you won't be sorry, because I guarantee we're going to get into some super cool stuff with Liz on the other side.
Oh yeah, we'll talk more about the secrets of antimatter and how to create it and the costs involved and what we can do with it. And there's a whole bunch more stuff to talk about. So you're going to want to click on that link, my friend. If you don't have enough time and you got to go, so be it. Maybe you'll join us next week on What If Discussed.